Ramayana, Part 49, The Killing of Ravana. Ravana returned to the battlefield in another chariot. Sri Rama himself encountered him. Gods assembled in the sky to witness the Rama-Ravana duel. Then Devendra thought, Ravana is seated in a magnificent chariot. Rama has to stand on the earth and fight? That would not be a fair fight. I shall give Rama my own chariot and the charioteer. He summoned his charioteer Matali and said, Matali, hasten to Lanka and respectfully offer Rama these astras and my chariot and be in charge of the chariot. Matali sped to Lanka and told Sri Rama of Indra's desire. Sri Rama was glad. He devoutly went round the chariot and then ascended it. The battle of battles began. The arrows which leapt from Ravana's bow assailed Sri Rama like serpents. Sri Rama overcame them with the Garudastra. Ravana sent forth thousands of arrows and damaged Sri Rama's chariot and wounded his charioteer. This misadventure infuriated Sri Rama. He frowned. Fire issued from his eyes as though to burn the enemy. His towering rage struck terror in everyone. The earth shook. The very mountain on which dwelt fierce creature like the lion and the tiger trembled. The trees swayed in fear. The sea was disturbed. Birds screeched in fear and clouds acquired fierce colors. Gandharvas, Yakshas and Kinnaras, as well as Rishis and Munis, gathered in the firmament to witness the duel between Sri Rama and Ravana. Ravana shot the Shulayudha to slay Sri Rama. It could strike with the terrifying power of a thunderbolt. It had steel nails all round. It could slay all evil spirits. When Ravana shot the Shulayudha, the Vanaras were in panic. What hope is there? They gasped and closed their eyes in terror. When Sri Rama seized it, whirled it round and round and hurled it, it exploded powerfully and broke into pieces. Then Rama shot the Trishiras, hard like diamond and sharp. They pierced Ravana's forehead. Sri Rama said to Ravana, Ravana, what happened to your much-wanted prowess? Where are your brothers, your sons and your army? See what disaster has flowed from your sin. You do not deserve to be forgiven. Just then, sage Agastya came there. He taught Sri Rama a mantra known as Aditya Hridaya. Sri Rama repeated the mantra devoutly. The sun god appeared and said, Sri Rama, I appreciate your devotion. Your wish will be fulfilled and you will be victorious in the battle. Once again, a fierce fight started between Sri Rama and Ravana. All the world shuddered. The other Rakshasas and Vanaras had their weapons, but watched the Sri Rama-Ravana duel with no thought of the weapons they held. Sri Rama shot sharp arrows and cut the standard on Ravana's chariot. Ravana struck Sri Rama's horses with mighty astras, but they were celestial steeds and the arrows could not hurt them. Ravana hurled a multitude of weapons like the mace, the wheel, the parigha, the club and the spike. Such menacing, looking and deadly weapons descended on Sri Rama's chariot and the Vanaras like rain. As he sent forth more and more astras, Ravana grew more and more exhilarated. Ravana, who was immersed in the duel, fixed thousands of arrows to his bowstring and went on assailing Sri Rama. Sri Rama retaliated with a number of arrows. A veritable roof was created in the sky by their arrows. Each cut the arrows of the other. Untiringly, they shot arrows, changing the bow from one hand to another. They roared and fought like incensed elephants. They fought like bulls which, even if they are hurt, recover and charge again. The duel of these two enraged combatants was thrilling and breathtaking. They fought to kill. Each glared at his antagonist in rage and assailed him. Their determination made them look fierce. Guiding the chariot in a battle itself is an art. Their charioteers were exceptionally skillful, and so they battled using a variety of movements. They faced each other and clashed fiercely. Sri Rama forced Ravana's horses to retreat, and Ravana wounded Matali. The entire world echoed and re-echoed the sounds of the weapons, the maces and the parigas they sent forth. Their astras fell into the distant seas and raised waves. They crashed into peaks and pounded and shattered them. Trees broke in the forests and fell to the ground. The gods and the Gandharvas exclaimed, Ah! This is indeed a battle. Never before has a duel been fought which could match this duel, nor will there ever be a duel to match this. Only the sky can compare with the sky, only the ocean with the ocean. Similarly, only the Rama-Ravana duel can be compared with the Rama-Ravana duel. Finally, Sri Rama employed the Nishitastra and cut off the head of Ravana. But oh wonder, another head appeared in its place. With another Astra, Sri Rama cut off that head. But yet, another appeared in its place. No matter how many times he cut off the head, another appeared. Sri Rama was worried. He reflected, how does this happen? Have my arrows been enfeebled? Or is this Ravana beyond the reach of death? My arrows slaughtered mighty Rakshasas like Khara, Dushana and killed even Vali. Why are they ineffective now? Then Matali said, Sri Rama, why are you in such a despair? Ravana's end approaches. Now employ the Brahmastra. Aim at Ravana's chest. Do not delay. Sri Rama drew out the Brahmastra. The great Agastya himself had given it to him. It had been created by Lord Brahma. Indra, the conqueror of the three worlds, had employed it. In the feathered base of the Brahmastra dwells Vayudeva, and in its blade dwell the sun god and Agni. Endowed with the energy of all living beings, it was lustrous like the sun and sent forth fire like a serpent. It could speed like lightning. It was so powerful that it could reduce mountains to powder. It was like the Vajrayuda. It was the most powerful of all the weapons in the world. Sri Rama took it out, empowered it with sacred verses, and fixed it to his bowstring. The entire world was panic-stricken. In great rage, Sri Rama pulled the string and, aiming at Ravana's chest, let it go with all his might, shooting forward like the Vajrayuda wielded by Indra. The Brahmastra struck Ravana in the chest. His chest burst. The bow slipped from Ravana's hands. His head bent to a side. His tongue stretched out. The eyeballs moved up and got stuck. Blood fell in torrents. Ravana fell down dead. The Brahmastra split open Ravana's chest and killed him, and then returned to Sri Rama's quiver. All the Vanaras burst into joyous shouts. The gods in the sky showered flowers and exclaimed, unrighteousness has been vanquished. Righteousness has won. The Rakshasas stood aghast at the death of Ravana, saying, we have been overcome. There is no meaning in fighting any further. They stopped fighting and surrendered to Sri Rama. Ravana's death overwhelmed Vibheeshana with grief. After all, they were brothers, however wicked Ravana might have been. Sri Rama said to the sobbing Vibheeshana, Vibheeshana, it is not right that you should grieve in this fashion. Ravana fought valiantly and has attained the heaven of the heroic. However evil he might have been, he fought bravely. He did not hide in the palace like a coward. That merits admiration. Go now to Lanka and make arrangements for the funeral. Ravana is dead and we can have no quarrel with him now. He has now gone to a world in which there is no hatred, no envy, no anger and no suffering. Now he is like a brother to me also. So go to Lanka now. Console Ravana's wives and children and grandchildren. You will be the next king, and that may make them apprehensive. They may fear that you will persecute them because you were hostile to Ravana. Go to them and relieve their fears. Assure them that your administration will not trouble them in the least. Give them your word that you will be guided by truth and dharma. Let Ravana's funeral be worthy of a great hero. Vibheeshana took some comfort. He decided to carry out Sri Rama's instruction. He went to Lanka and called on Mandodari and the other wives of Ravana. They were stupefied by the death of their husband. Vibheeshana comforted them with timely words of consolation. He organized the funeral of Ravana on a grand scale. Then Sri Rama called Hanumanta and said, Hanumanta, go at once to Ashokavana and tell Sita Devi that I have killed Ravana. Bring her here. Hanumanta at once leapt to Ashokavana. He bowed to Sita Devi and said, Mother, do you remember me? I am Hanumanta. Once I brought a message from Sri Rama to you. Now I bring very auspicious news. Sri Ramachandra fought a grim battle with Ravana. Ravana was killed. The Rakshasas surrendered. Sri Ramachandra has commanded me to take you to him. Be pleased to come with me. Joy and wonder bewildered Sita. She fainted, unable to bear her ecstasy. She recovered after a while and said, Hanumanta, what joyous news have you brought? My good fortune dawns again. Sri Ramachandra has slain Ravana. Oh, my good fortune is matchless. She visualized the joyous days ahead and smiled. She recalled the misfortunes of the past and sobbed bitterly. She set out to see Sri Rama in ecstatic excitement. Sita and Hanumanta approached Sri Rama. Sri Rama looked at Sita and she looked at him. Joy, love and excitement danced in the eyes of both. Both thought of fate which had long separated them and shed tears. Sita Devi ran to Sri Rama and touched his feet with her forehead. Her tears fell on his feet like grains of akshata. It was a spectacle to fill the beholders with joy and grief at the same time. Then, suddenly, Sri Rama said to Sita Devi, "Sita, all these days you were in the house of another man, so how can others be certain that your chastity has not been tainted?" The word struck Lakshmana, Sugriva, Hanumanta and other Vanara heroes like a bolt from the blue. "What? Doubt Sita Devi's purity?" they exclaimed. Sri Rama had not the slightest doubt about the spotless purity of Sita Devi. His object was to bring home to everyone her purity. Only Sita Devi knew this. She was not upset. She said to Sri Rama, "My Lord, I know what is in your heart. I am not in the least unhappy. Whether people doubt my chastity or not, I shall prove my purity. That is my duty too." And she turned towards Lakshmana. She said, "Lakshmana, prepare a pit of fire." The Vanara leaders were stunned by her resolve. They wept saying, "Will Sita Devi enter fire? We set her free from imprisonment. Is it all in vain? Our fighting the war has served no purpose. What will happen if Sita Devi enters the fire?" With a heavy heart, Lakshmana prepared a big fire. He placed together faggots of sandalwood and other superior wood and lighted them. Sita walked up to the blazing fire. Everybody watched, hardly able to breathe. Sita Devi looked up at the sky with folded hands. Addressing the gods, she said, "Lord Brahma and other gods, I bow to you all. I was separated from my husband for a long time. I was in the house of another man. I could not avert what providence had ordained. But during this long period, my body, mind and speech all rested only in my husband and Lord Sri Ramachandra. The name of my Lord Sri Ramachandra is engraved upon my heart. If it is true that not the faintest spot sullies my chastity, let the fire god save me." She then went round the fire and jumped into it. The Vanaras cried aloud in anguish. The next moment, the effulgent Lord Agni, the fire god, rose from the flames, carrying Sita Devi in his arms like a child. She had not suffered the least harm. On the other hand, she was more radiant than before. She was far lovelier than before, giving the smiling Sita Devi to Sri Ramachandra. The fire god said, "Sri Rama, Sita Devi is the purest of the pure. No one can doubt her purity. It is a grievous sin to do so. Accept her." Lord Indra and other gods appeared and praised Sita Devi's chastity. They eulogized both Sri Rama and Sita Devi and sang their praises. The Vanaras shouted in joy. Sri Rama assembled all the Vanara heroes. He expressed his gratitude to all the Vanaras who had assisted him in locating Sita, overcoming Ravana and reuniting him with his wife. He prayed to Indra to restore all the dead Vanaras to life, and the boon was granted. Then Sri Rama said, "Vibheeshana, my mission here is over. After you are crowned, I will return to Ayodhya. I have promised Bharata that I shall be in Ayodhya as soon as the period of 14 years ends. The period is coming to an end. How Bharata will be pining for me. I must return at once."